Okay, great. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. This is Sanjeev Mota from BNK Securities. On behalf of BNK, I welcome you all to another session of our Ideation Fireside Chat. We have with us the management team of Matrimony.com. We have Mr. Murugavel Janakiraman, CEO and founder, and we have Mr. Sushant Pai, CFO. Welcome, gentlemen, to this fireside chat, and thank you for giving us your valuable time.
Thank you, Sanjeev. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and we also have Deep Shah, who is an analyst at the internet sector. So, what the way we'll do it, sir, is I'll start by asking questions. Mm-hmm. What we'll do is I'll ask more organizational level questions and strategic level questions. And then Deep has a few questions also on the company. So we'll do that. Anybody else has a question, please put it on the Q&A chat and we'll make sure we'll ask that question. So that's how we'll kind of do it. Right. So maybe I can start with my first question, sir. So I was watching an old interview of yours where you had said that you are an accidental entrepreneur. So maybe I'd love to hear your journey, you know, where did you start? Maybe very briefly, because you know a lot of people may know it, but I thought it would be good for people who don't know the journey to start with that. And how have you built this organization?
Thanks, Sanjeev. The accidental entrepreneur, it's because I did not strategize about matrimony business when I got into the business. So I was dabbling with what I want to do in my life. So that was way back in 1997. So I didn't have any idea on which idea to begin with. So I tried doing an online Tamil community website. It's the more of building a Tamil community website, providing various services, which I thought would be useful to the Tamil community. So I was adding various sections, and the matrimony was one such section. So it took almost 2.5 years. Then I figured out there's an opportunity in the matrimony. Since then, no looking back. So I did not have any idea. So after trying out various things of on the community website, then I got an idea of matrimony. Over a period of time, I became passionate with the matrimony. Today, matrimony has become a purpose. So when I talk about entrepreneurship, from no idea to idea to idea to passion, purpose, passion to a purpose, it's evolved from these four stages. And it's also kind of reminds you of when people talk about the passion So basically, something that, we can work on what you are something passionate about it, or just focus on what you are good at. Then you can identify what you'll become passionate with. So I was good at computer programming language. So, I was just focusing on what I was good at. And then eventually found an idea and I became passionate about it. And over a period, it became, kind of, it's a purpose. Today, what is our purpose? Building a better Bharat through happy marriages. So because we fundamentally believe in the marriages are the founding block of any society. If you take care of the marriages, the kids coming out of the marriages can become a good citizen. This good citizen can build a better future, better country. So in fact, you have a service called happymarriage.com, which are trying to revamp. The purpose of happymarriage.com is help people to stay happily married. While the website was not much focused, but once again, reviving that whole thing, content. So definitely through Happy Marriages website, we want to ensure that each and every marriage in India, irrespective of whether they got married through matrimony.com or not, we want to ensure that every marriage in India is successful, happier, and you can, in the process, build a better Bharat. So that's why I call this accident entrepreneur, because I did not strategize about matrimony, got into the business. So that's where the whole journey began, from Tamil County website to matrimony.com.
Right, sir. So you talked briefly about the culture and purpose. So you, in fact, your annual report says purpose-led growth. And, if you can just talk a bit about the organizational culture, how you build, in terms of purpose of, what is your organization? How would you define the culture?
Okay. Well, the purpose, I said, building a better Bharat through happy marriages. In fact, our communication, standard communication to our associates is that matrimony.com is one of the noble professions. Like we consider that there are a couple of professional noble professions. One is the healthcare, one is the education, And in our view, that matchmaking is another noble profession, because we believe that we are doing a God's work. Okay, through God, through us, the God is fulfilling that, you know, the two souls, the God wants to unite. We believe that, you know, that's happening through us. So we say that, look, every action of ours, don't think that you are telecalling or doing, you know, or you are doing a personal services, the relationship manager, they are, you know, helping the people to get married. Think that is a blessing that, you know, you have got a chance to, you know, help the two souls to kind of come together in the marriage. So somehow you have been placed in the role, you know, kind of, we tell them, okay, the God has chosen you to kind of play the role. If not for that call, if not for the service, the entire marriage would not have culminated, you know, solemnized into marriage. So basically, you are playing the higher purpose. So don't think that you are doing that role. I think you have been placed to the role to fulfill that, you know, that happy marriage. So we kind of noble profession, because the relation to the customer, or the gratitude to the customer around matchmaking, is a lifelong. Okay, today I meet people who got married to us for 10 years, 15 years. Okay, they still, you know, thank us, because of you, I got married, you know, kind of happily married. So you won't tell for any other product. I go and tell you, I bought a shirt, okay, I bought a shirt, I go and thank the manufacturer. But it's not the case matchmaking. The lifelong gratitude people have for our service, I think it's a noble profession. So for us, that thing of what is the purpose, ladies? It's not about making money. We are fulfilling the purpose, the byproduct of making money. I think that's what gives that happiness and satisfaction that, you know, and make all our associates understand that we are playing, the bigger purpose. And it's a God's work getting fulfilled through our service. I think that's where we position, and we believe that way, actually.
So just coming to the business model, maybe if you can briefly talk about the business model in terms of how and what are the key metrics that you as a company kind of focus on, you know, when you evaluate your business every year. So it would be great to just talk about the business model and what are the key things that you focus on.
See, the key things for us, a couple of things. See, the business has the three parameters. Okay, the three main drivers. Number of profiles, on how many of those profiles, and then the free members signing up on the platform, how many of those members you're able to convert, the percentage of the conversion, or how many people you're able to convert into paid members, at what ARPU. So this is the top three numbers. So if the profiles moves up, or the conversion moves up, or ARPU moves up, the revenue per user moves up, then the overall business, the number moves up. Look at the last four quarters, Sanjeev, that we have been doing, having a double-digit growth, the consistent double-digit growth. We expect the growth moment to continue on account of multiple factors. One is that definitely there is increase in profile acquisition. That's one of the key levers. And second thing, the number of paid conversions. That number has been moving up. Look at the last four quarters. We had a consistent 20%+ growth on the number of paid transactions. Okay, then ARPU. Well, ARPU has been sort of flat because conscious decision that, you know, you want to reduce price in certain segment, because today we get members across countries, you know, belong to various social state of society, tier three, members signing from tier three or people from all walks of life. So we, you know, kind of have the differentiated pricing strategies, you know, for different segments. So that's one of the reasons why the ARPU was slightly down. But again, we look at that number of paid numbers. Subscriptions are moved up on a year-on-year basis, growing at a 20%+. So basically, these are the key things. But obviously, business, they look at various parameters, you know, kind of daily active user, various engagement. But we look at that on the revenue side. These are the three top metrics, which is obviously we don't share the profile at this point of time. But if we talk about the number of paid subscription, which the number, as I said, which has been growing at a very healthy pace, 20%+. We expect that similar moment to continue.
Right. So one of the things that, you know, worry for a lot of investors have been over last few years in terms of growth, that is the, you know, and I think the question is the J curve, because you already have a reasonable market share. And as you said, if you look at the three things that you are growing, if that grows, then the market grows and you grow with that. But if you look at most internet businesses, I think the way people think of them as that huge J curve, that hockey stick that's going to happen. Is that in the current business that you have, and let's just talk about the matchmaking side, and then we'll come to the services end. Is that J curve, main part of the J curve, over, or what is your view on that? Like, how can you energize that business Because last 2-3 years there's been a bit of stagnation in that business.
Yeah, look at Sanjay, they're good questions. Again, let me respond to that. Look at last 4 quarters, we had a double digit growth, which is expected double-digit growth to continue. See, the services is sort of has been there for a very long time. Okay, like matchmaking, jobs, or you know, B2B services, be it even IndiaMART, be it even Just Dial, or you know, kind of the services you under the many services been there for the last 20 years. But these services grow at a double digit. Okay, these services will not grow at 100% on year, not that kind of growth. Even Naukri for that matter, the growth has been sort of a double digit growth. It's not that they had a 50%, 100% growth. But they had a double digit growth consistently for over a period of time. They are little lagged off, obviously, outgunned of us. You know, we are at around sort of 400 plus crore, they are at around 800 plus crore, which sort of we believe that, you know, we are behind 3-4 years on the in terms of the jobs, in terms of scale and size. I think it's about one of the reasons our growth was impacted on double digit growth because suddenly, you know, we had a serious competition. You know, it was not the case with other players, which is kind of beat Naukri, beat even IndiaMART, beat and you know, other players. So unfortunately, after our listing, suddenly this category got into an hyper competitive mode, and suddenly the marketing spend has gone up. Look at another 3-4 years ago, the marketing spend was sort of at a certain level. Now marketing spend moved up. In spite of that, we're still able to now got in double digit growth and able to show the good increase in EBITDA margin because this business has a strong operating leverage. So I don't expect you'll have a J curve because it's not business something launched recently. Today the business which having J curve and all, suddenly have because we've been there for from 1 million users being there. Again, the growth is getting better, no doubt about it, because this adoption takes place. Because suddenly not double the number of users going to sign up on the matchmaking platform.
That's right.
It's not the case with other new services because these are the people adopting the new services, okay, and they can have the certain level of growth and all those things. Because they are still in there, maybe that you know this business are not fully penetrated. Again, matchmaking still there a phenomenal scope to grow in terms of the number of users looking for live partner. We continue to work on various ways to accelerate the growth. But the growth can be 50%, may not be. Can you get into 20% growth and with the increase in EBITDA? Look at last year profit grew by 40%. This year it'll be 50%+ or 50% profit margin. You expect that the profit growing at a much faster pace and top line growing at term. And this year expecting a 15-20% growth. We expect that kind of growth. So we can't aspire for a 40-50% growth until otherwise some fundamental or structural things happen. Probably, you know, if you end up in acquiring some other competitors, you know, so there are some kind of benefit you may get out of that. But still, as a matrimony, in spite of having the current competitive level, still we are grow at this kind of healthy top line growth. And the most important thing about strong operating margin, EBITDA continuing to go and grow, we are continuing to improve the market share. We continue to divide the gap between us and the competitors. I think that's getting widened. I believe that it's a matter of time. Probably people may realize that they're fighting a losing battle. Like internet per se, in spite of hyper competitive, they're not able to significantly move the needle. Even the info had spent a good amount of money last 3 years on Jeevan Saathi, 250 crore, hardly needle has moved. And even further widening in the gap. And again, I respect the individual company, they are a different strategy. But the thing is, as a leader, we continue to go to drive the growth and continue to drive the EBITDA margin. To come back on a question, J curve may not happen. Can the healthy growth? Yes. Can you have that 15-20% growth or maybe better growth? Yeah, that is definitely possible. So that's what you are driving. Again, this combination of everything. Product strategies, pricing strategies, and you know our offerings, I think all is going to play a role. Again, we continue work on various things to further accelerate the growth. But the good thing that now we are in a good double-digit growth and increase in EBITDA margin. I think that's a thing. And PAT is moving at a very healthy percentage. And we expect that to continue. And because today the further single largest cost is that the marketing cost, which is 38%. And look at a gross margin business, a 67% gross margin business. In spite of spending 38% marketing, our EBITDA and matchmaking is 27%. Like, and one thing about while that the business in terms of growth, but one thing I can tell you that I know to wake up or you know one day morning and see whether the business will be there or not. As long as humanity exists, this business will be there. And the other strong, the network effect, strong penetration, the strong fundamentals. So I think one thing about this business, it's been there for 20 years and it has strong foundation, strong fundamentals. So the foundation is very strong, but the growth has been certain percentage, but the foundation on this thing has been very, very strong. So which continue to grow on the foundation, continue to get better, EBITDA margin continue to get better. So the incremental growth will flow into bottom line. So, and I'm quite excited about that. The growth plus also, if we're working on various ways to accelerate the growth. We are expanding to Bangladesh. We hope that Bangladesh operation will be, starting next month. We are looking at Sri Lanka as the next operation. We are MuslimMatch.com. The global Muslim, it's a 1 billion population, and we have a MuslimMatch.com for the global Muslims, not for Indian Muslims. Indian Muslim, we have MuslimMatrimony.com. We have MuslimMatch.com, like African Muslim Match, American Muslim Match, or Arab Muslim Match. We are looking at the global Muslim as another target, another opportunity. So combination of India plus global Muslim, it's almost, we are looking at targeting one third of the world population. So the long-term outlook, then wedding service, another thing, which you recently bought Shadi Saga. I think with the integration, we'll become a strong number in wedding services. We believe that that business is sort of slowly going up. But then once the integration done, I think that the growth will be much better. I think combination of matching and wedding service can possibly get into much better growth. Again, a lot of work is happening, and but the good thing that the matchmaking is on the move.
Right. So I'll come back to this wedding services bit, and that looks pretty exciting. But before that, just a kind of more a philosophical question. The fact that you are listed, the fact that you are started making cash flows pretty early on, is that actually a negative sometimes, that you become too conservative and not want to grow, and not want to burn cash, so to say?
See, it's not about, the burning cash. So it's about, kind of whether university begin the right places. So obviously, yes, we are just a balanced little bit on the growth versus to kind of probably a couple of years before. And but today we have a good amount of money, which you're able to invest in the market. We're almost spending close to 40 crore per quarter on marketing. See, for us, we can still afford and we still make a thing. So we're still investing, because today, probably for the money, the investing, probably some market because hyper competition, probably, for the North market particularly, yeah, probably that's one area where you need to definitely get better. So yes, can you increase the marketing from 40 to 50 crore? Yeah, if there is a need and opportunity, but I think definitely invest, okay? And if you're able to kind of see that opportunity grow and all. And yes, marketing spend has been growing. So it's not that, if you look at the time of IPO, our marketing spend was 15 crore and 3 years ago. Today, the marketing spend is 40 crore. So it's almost like 25 crore we invest in marketing. So it's not that as a company, I've been staying conservative, and we're definitely investing behind it, no doubt about it. And so that continue to do, so wherever see the opportunity invest. And so that's one of the reasons we are telling that marketing continue to go to improve. But again, what the key message you want to give, definitely there'll be increased top line growth will be there. We continue to invest on marketing because we invest going after newer market, newer opportunities, and EBITDA continue to go to increase. I think whether we want to increase marketing 40 to 60 crore at the pandemic, we think it's not warranted. So
coming to wedding services and also on the website, a couple of things. You've seen a big change. One is COVID has obviously accelerated more digital thought process, and people are, adopting digital much more. But also, I think the profile of people on your website is changing, or people who are registering is changing, right? It was more parents. Now the potential groom and potential bride are themselves also coming on. I think the gender has also shifted a bit from what I understand. Is there now a thing to revamp the website or revamp things to kind of make it more relevant to the current people who are now coming in, and then add more services to them? So for just for example, like a speed dating, which is not an Indian concept yet, but it has been there in some form or the other. And I think given that you can create things far better, are these some things that you can do to kind of make the excitement in this space itself right now?
Sanjeev, a couple of things. One is that we are a matrimony company, okay? Right. We are clear about what business you want to operate. Right. So that way that, as a company, you cannot get into each and every thing. So whether speed dating as a thing. But in terms of, because first of all, we see the dating as a very small opportunity. We don't see that's a mainstream that become anything bigger. So I'm a very strong views on that one. Because look at that, the dating site been there for almost what, 10 years. But today, none of the players, local player, not even cross $2 million. On the category, matrimony is much larger because it has a wider adoption. So that way that, also a company cannot get into each and everything. So we have to stand for kind of what it really believes. And we believe definitely matrimony is a very large opportunity, which definitely continue going to grow for all the reasons. And second thing about incomes or that shifting in profile, no, it's happened long time back, Sanjeev, because today almost like more than 75% of the users are the individual themselves. The parents are only 15%.
Right.
So that shift has a long time back. So it's COVID is not something, in fact, that is further accelerating. So probably the matter of time for the 78% probably became 80% of the profile will be created by individual themselves, which is very large. Parents, though it's constituted around 15%, they continue to play a role, but parents not be complete out of it. So in a way that, you know, the product has largest become the individual's play, and those some personal profile created by parents. So that shift is up long time back, but only we expect that further move up because more and more singles come to come down it. However, we can't completely, you know, kind of eliminate parents and even siblings using a site, because India, the parents, sometimes the parent take the responsibility and sibling do take the responsibility. But good thing that it's largely an individual play and singles themselves using the website. So, but again, the interesting thing about, we continue to add a product feature, which, you know, make it very easy and attractive or appealing for the younger generation. If during the COVID time, we launched a video calling feature.
Okay. Yeah.
So like that, you know, continue to innovate the future, which has the appeal or which changing with the current situation where, you know, probably the video adoption has been very strong, so that people can use video as a way to connect even before they meet in person. So like that, as a company, continue to evolve, continue to improve on the product and services. But definitely, and when it comes to matrimony, in fact, we are want to make the matrimony platform as a more safe and secure and, you know, most trustworthy platform. The one thing we're clear about matrimony.com, right from the beginning, you want to be the company to be seen as the most credible and trusted matrimony player. One thing about today, people talk about matrimony, that trust and credibility comes as the number one thing. Because that has built over a period of time. You continue to make progress in those directions. Some other features what you launched, ID verifications. We are the only portal offer 6-point verification service, where the members can verify ID, selfie, education certificates, occupation certificate, income certificate, plus also that location. So we have that the strong, the 6-point verification feature like that. So one hand to work on that, you know, strengthening the credibility of the offering, plus continue to innovate so that, you know, it has that that coolness or appeal. I think probably would have meant that one. So I think you continue progress on both the directions.
Right. So sir, just to sum up on the matchmaking side, if I look at 5 years down the line, you know what? So, as you said, market is there in India. Obviously, the huge market in India. One change would be more people getting onto digital, and the second would be more people becoming paid on this, right? So that would be where the growth is coming from. What would be like? What kind of ballpark numbers you think is possible? At how much digital adoption you think will happen? What is the total market size could be? In, you know, 5 years down the line for a digital player.
So the thing is that as you know, the study what you have done, around 60 million people in India look for a life partner at any point of time. But today the category adoption has been around maybe 7 or 8 million. So there is definitely the, you know, strong headroom to grow. I believe as a company we also need to work on some of our offerings so that, you know, to make that adoption much better and much faster. So we expect that, you know, we believe that this year we are looking at 15-20% growth. We expect sort of that sort of growth, okay? And if there are some structural changes, the growth can be much better. However, on with the current scheme of thing, we expect possibly that kind of growth possibilities there. I think the outlook for that, yeah, probably you can have the double digit growth, possibly around 15-20%.
So you're saying about 12% adoption today out of 60 million, 7-8 million, right?
Yeah.
You think, let's assume that 60 million remains 60 million 5 years down the line. You think this number would become 20 million of people who are doing this, or what's your thought or guess, best guess?
Yeah, no, I think that's a possibility. Okay, that's a possibility because the digital adoption has been strong and getting better. So,
right, sure, okay. Sir, coming to the other part, which is actually a much bigger market, right? It's almost like a $50 billion market, and it depends on what can be your wallet size within that of the managed, this the whole services business. So, what's your plan on that? You've obviously done a bit of acquisition and things here, But what's, you know, how easy is it to actually consolidate this business, or is it still very fragmented? And again, just trying to understand your strategy. Would you want to be a marketplace here? How would you want to do this?
Yeah, thanks, Sanjeev. You know, we sort of, you know, went off a different segment and opportunity on wedding services. It was, we are largely focused on photography venture. And we realized that as a company, you know, getting into a full service model was an outright strategy, because as we expanded into the opportunity, you know, we had a challenges of, you know, executing and, you know, and the issues came along with that, the ramping up the wedding photography business. We realized that as an internet company, better off stay as a marketplace model. So we decided to shut down that photography business. So we thought, okay, photography, very large opportunity. Let's make the unorganized business, organized business. We be the full service provider of it. All of it. But we realized, you know, I think we better be a marketplace model. So we have mandap.com, which is, you know, we want to be the India's largest venue discovery and booking platform. Mandap.com definitely, you know, addresses the current challenge faced by the individual, that when you want to book a venue, there's no single place for them to go and identify the venues available for the given date and budget. So we are making progress in that direction. That's on mandap.com. We are clearly solving the problem which are faced by the people. So currently we have the listings. We are India's largest venue discovery platform, around 18,000 listings. But however, still we need to crack that, you know, available information. I think because, you know, during the COVID time, anyway, the weddings are not happening. I think once able to get that venue availability information, we have the listing, we continue to make progress on the listing side. I think we definitely fundamentally solve the problem. When you solve the problem, definitely you can monetize. Today, there are people who are paying for the Mandap as a subscription business model. And what is the model of both Mandap.com, WeddingBazaar.com? It's a two-sided marketplace model. The business model is subscription, where the vendors are paying money for the leads. So I think we moved to a simple model similar to what Beta India model, Beta Just Dial, and other working on it. Get the service provider, give them the value, they will pay for the value in terms of lead what they are generating. So in terms of wedding services, so far no one has made it big because of whatever reasons. And we definitely believe that we have the opportunity, because one thing that for us is a forward integration. Because other players, the challenge has been getting the people are wedding ready customer. For us, the wedding ready customers are already with the matchmaking platform. So I think definitely, no, it is not, we are not tightly integrate our wedding service platform, the matchmaking platform, plus, you know, in terms of way the business model, what you are initially was focusing on, the full service model plus commission model, we realized that you rather be a subscription model. Initially, you know, launch even wedding services, the business model, commission based business model. We pass on the lead, then we get the commission. I think thanks to, you know, the way that things change in India, the last 4 or 5 years, the adoption of the subscription business model has substantially gone up the worldwide. So we decided rather than the commission business model, let's move to a subscription business model. So we've done all these changes. Now actually people are today paying for subscription. It's once you integrate our Saadi Saga into our wedding offering, we with that we become number one in both in mandap.com and weddingbazaar.com. So it's more that, you know, building that, you know, one hand on listing side and generate the traffic, generate the leads, and get more vendors to pay for it, then, you know, keep putting the value, then, you know, this subscription business model will continue to move up. So though it's in the very early stage, but believe the growth on wedding services will definitely much better. I think, but the smaller base, we expect this business probably grow in a triple digit growth. Again, it's a small base, even triple digit growth really looks small. If 50 lakhs become 1 crore, it's not a bad, but again, the growth acceleration on wedding services will be good, because we believe that number one, because it'll be the largest number of listing and people adopting subscription business model. And we are the number one, we have that forward integration opportunity. And with the Saadi's acquisition, we not only get the listing, we also have the leadership, the bandwidth, the required bandwidth, which was, you know, obviously one of the challenges in wedding services. I think that's also falling in place. The acquisition is almost done. I think once with integration, then I think maybe 1 quarter down the line, we're going to be able to start leveraging the benefits of the combined entities.
Right. So as you said, the client acquisition cost is not here because you already have the clients in a way. So what I'm trying to understand is that now that client is, let's say, paying X amount of money, you think that with all these services, they could even, for example, at some point of time, double what they are paying now or even more, right? Because the services that can be pretty big, right? And
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the thing is that today, who is paying money for us is the vendors are paying the money. They are the one, right, paying subscription money to get more leads. But we are not charging our customers. Going forward, there's opportunity even charge the customer availing the service so they can get them a better deals and all. But I, at this point of time, we are only getting the revenue on the supply side, which is the vendor side. Sorry, revenue on the vendor side, not on the customer side. But though, as you progress, there are opportunity to provide some service and monetize it.
So have you thought through, like, in terms of next 4-5 years, what could be the opportunity space here and how big is this place? In the sense that obviously we know the total market size, some number, but how much of it can be addressed with this, is something like this?
In fact, other day I was talking to one of the guys who has some bit of work on this space. He's talking to photography alone, talking how many photographers there will be there in India who charge around 50,000 rupees for the wedding. You are sharing a number of probably around 5 lakhs people. Okay, I don't know whether one category alone. So even look at the photography is once, I think you have the mandaps, you have decorators, honeymoon service provider, and makeup artists. Today this category is thing, when apparel, jewelry, the opportunity is big. It's more of you have to get these players into the ecosystem and ensure they get the value, and in the process how we can maximize value in that segment. So at this point of time, we'll stay as the subscription business model. Once you kind of got to the required number of listing, once you have the rhythm set in place in terms of large number of paid vendors, then the value capturing can be much better. There are multiple ways you can capture the value. Well, begin as a subscription business model, but you have to get that base right. I think we are definitely probably in the right direction on this one. So whether how can it become, yes, because it's a very large opportunity.
Right.
And become 1,000 crore company or 5,000 crore company. Yes, there are opportunities at that. I think we have to get to that the listing and certain number of people paying subscription money. I think those things are falling in place.
Right. So at this point, are you matchmaking and marriage services? These are the two opportunities that you are looking at. Are you looking at anything? And plus, not just India, outside India as well, as you said, in a couple of places like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and then maybe something else. So is this right now what you're looking at, or you are thinking of some other product lines?
Yeah. No, at this point, they focus on matchmaking wedding services. I think the thing is that we have to take the matchmaking 500 crore run rate from here at 400 plus crore. I think hopefully the next couple of quarters, you want to get a matchmaking investment of 500 crore run rate, then get the wedding service into a triple digit growth and expand into the opportunities in the matchmaking page, be it the global matrimony offerings or the Muslim match, which I spoke about. So continue to look for opportunity, expand matchmaking business, be it within India or outside of India. India, we did launch some new offerings, like we launched Doctor's Matrimony, we launched IAM, IAT Matrimony, we launched Rajasthani Matrimony. We kind of look for opportunity to expand or offer Indian market in the matchmaking space, wedding services space, global matrimony and global matchmaking initiative, where we believe that we can make a difference, like Muslim match, one such opportunity I spoke about. At this point, that's our focus. The near-term focus, take the matrimony to a 500 crore company and take the EBITDA margin to 27-30%. And then continue to drive that double-digit growth of possibly that around 15% growth, 15-20% growth. And so that's what you're looking at.
Sure.
Maybe that maybe change in the future, if there is a thing about over there, as you progress, maybe then you can look at what else you can do in terms of how we can make use of our cash, and we'll figure it out.
Right. Yes, sir. Deep, I'll hand it over to you for your questions.
Thanks, Sanjeev. Thanks, Murja, sir, for doing this. My questions were more on this interesting pricing change you did last year. So would it be fair to say that your South ATVs would be substantially higher than your North ATVs currently?
Yeah, that's a fair assumption. Yeah, that's right also. Because we have enjoy very large market opportunity. So pricing is definitely much better.
Right. So, sir, this whole thing of differential ATVs, would you attribute it more to the difference about adoption to this model or the economic realities, or it is just because you are so strong in the southern market that you can charge a lot more?
It's a combination of both, because even the south, certain segments, based on the socioeconomic status. We look at the different strategies. Yeah.
Right. So then, so what is happening right now is probably in the northern and western markets, there's sort of a tense battle going on between two or three players. So then what is that sort of market share that you see when those network effects kick in, that you can start charging a premium just because you have a lot more CVs on your portal? So is it 40% market share? Is it 50%? And how do we think of it?
In which market, Deep? Sorry, I missed it. Yeah.
So say, for example, the way in the southern markets, you can charge a lot more.
Yeah.
So what is that market share number that gives you that leeway that just because you have a lot more resumes on your platform, or you can start charging more for just that fact?
No, we have we look at the south, probably Tamil Nadu, Andhra, Kerala, Karnataka. These are probably 90%+ market share. Okay,
right.
And west, when we come to east also, probably around 60-70% market share. The west also a leader. We probably have from 40-45% market share. So, but again, we're not the level of, I think when you have the 60-70%, I think that's where you become a dominant player. Okay. If you are still around like north and west, north probably around 30%+, and west, you know, but you are the leader, but the leadership by, you know, certain margin only. It's not that the leadership like at least if you have leadership like what you have in east, which is around maybe around 60-70%, where you can definitely charge a better price. I think that's where the challenge in the west and north. So obviously your ARPU is less in those market, but it's getting better. In fact, while even the Q1 for that matter, while the overall growth almost 30%, north and west had a better growth. So in terms of the percentage growth, but again, having said that, we definitely long is north. Definitely we need to continue to improve market share. So that's one of the reason even other players are not making any big growth or they continue to, we are the only profit making company because of, while enjoy the strong dominance in most of the markets and while fighting out in one of the markets.
Right. So continuing this market share question, so we have shut down some offices in South, but we continue to have an offline term online model. Do you think this offline term online model will help us faster gain market share in northern markets, or we'll stick to an online model there?
No, sorry, we didn't shut down anything. In fact, our offices, we did not shut down anything. So,
no, we have. So, some sales force is rationalized. So, the point is the offline term online model that we have in southern markets. So, the idea is, will that help us gain market share a lot faster in northern markets, or we will stay an online only player?
No, we have our model right from the beginning has been always being a combination online play and offline. The offline means that you do have kind of people reaching out to the customer, and again, we're talking about retail outlets. If you're talking about that one, we have 130 outlets, while definitely a good number of outlets are the present in the South market, where you have the strong thing. Retail outlets will be selective, okay? Only if required in certain market, we'll add a retail outlet. I think while we have the offline touch will be there, we have telecaller, we have relationship managers reaching out to the customer offering services. In terms of retail outlets, yes, it's largely in South India. We have definitely East and West is there. North also has some outlets, but not a level of penetration because retail definitely in terms of infrastructure, cars, other things. So while in terms of the way you operate, it'll be online plus offline. A physical present retail outlet, yes, it's not something like we're not going to go, further. Well, there is some addition to happen, but you're not going to go all out on those things.
See, we have two types of offices. One is our offices where people come and do telecalling. There are sales people, there is corporate people. There are regular offices and that remain. In fact, we have expanded there like Pune and Mysore. The second types of office is basically the retail, which is just a small store with two people to help parents, to help somebody who's technically challenged, who can come and walk in and register, things like that. So that we keep evaluating because we have an MIS. For example, we may have chosen a location which not be the right location. So we keep moving. Sometimes we reduce it and we realize that it's not the right location. And in this pandemic, we have taken some calls on those, which are not profit making or not yielding the right. Some of those we would have optimized it. But that's not a significant change from what it was earlier. So the two types of offices that we have across India.
Thanks, Susan.
So second question is on this whole advertising piece. So while I understand why it has changed and how it has moved, so how do we exactly plan to track the efficacy of our spends? Because we also spend a lot on TV, which is brand marketing, but then you also have point of purchase advertising, and you also have on the spot discounts to incentivize, which is netted off from revenues. So how do we now, with more and more people coming online, how do we track this efficacy spend, and do we plan to shift more to digital? What is the thought process here?
Deep, yes, I agree with you. Large part of our spend is on TV. I think there's one famous thing when people talk about offline marketing. I know 50% TV marketing work. I don't know which 50% is. I think that's one popular quote by marketers. Okay, nobody knows which 50% work. And so we have to invest money on marketing by brand building. However, definitely we continue to move the spend to the digital. That's continued to happen. But still, the TV plays a very large, because I think for the brand building or considering that kind of the competitive intensity in the market, we stepped up marketing. So yes, that's slightly that shift is towards digital happening, but still large part of our marketing spend will continue to remain on TV.
Right. That's all from my end.
Okay. Discounts, we don't treat it as marketing spends.
Yeah, that's the thing. Yeah, discount you won't treat as a marketing spend, which is what the revenue we talk about is net of discount. So
you
know that our marketing spends are pure marketing. And one thing that, I think that is one of the important point I want to tell you, Deep, because the brand has been so strong. Look at our profile acquisition. Almost would say the 80% of profile acquisitions are organic, where people, come to our portal, download their app, and create a thing where there's no direct cost associated with it. I think that's the power of the brand, what we created. So I think, to continue to spend money, but the brand pull reach has been very good.
So that was all from my end.
A couple of questions again, sir. So one is on data analytics. I guess now, given more and more, I guess even marriage services, the fact that you get into marriage services, I think data analytics become that much more interesting to do what to offer who and things like that. So is there a big spend that you're looking at to create that engine? I'm sure you already have, but I'm saying in terms of actually bolstering that engine.
No, I think the good thing that Sanjeev, we started investing in the data analytics and data warehouse long time back. We built a data lake. We have that strong data capture mechanism. We have an analytical team. So we continue to kind of analyze and take insights and putting the insights into various areas of business, from product side, sales side, service side. So we continue to we have a strong team in place. The required infrastructure in place, the required technology in place. It's just definitely continue to invest in that area. The investment is going to be incremental because the foundation is there, people are there. Yes, continue to invest because that's definitely one of the areas. Continue to invest and so that we can leverage the benefit out of this analytical piece. Yeah.
Sure. Also, sir, in what we keep hearing is in terms of shortage of people in this whole area, right? And you keep hearing from IT companies that they've had to increase salaries more than once, and so on. What is your experience here?
Okay, I think thankfully that Chennai has a sufficient talent pool, because Tamil Nadu, you may know that 20% engineers what India produces. Okay,
right.
That's coming from 20% of that coming from Tamil Nadu. The Tamil Nadu compared to other locations like Bangalore or be it Delhi and all, one thing that the number of internet companies or things in a way is sort of fairly limited. Not definitely, we see definitely the company from like good success and the enough talent pool available from the lot of, we talk about IT services company, there are talent pool available. While it's not, we're not facing challenges, so we definitely have a fair bit of talent. We've taken some proactive step. We identify that the key talent, we have worked on some kind of retention mechanism, and so we did take some step on, we worked on retention strategy on key people, but which can't obviously fit for each and every person. So we continue to strengthen our our recruitment on the tech side, but definitely we face some bit of attrition, no doubt about it, which is still at a manageable level. So we've taken care of the key people and we continue to strengthen. And thankfully that thing is about, it's not the kind of bloodbath what some other regions are facing now, but we are still fairly better. But however, we're not taking like, we continue to work on strengthening our tech team and all that. I think we are fairly, our leadership team is very strong. The key people have been good and taken care of. And so that way, I think we are fairly in on a reasonable ground. Yes, definitely it's a challenge, and which everybody going through. I'm sure you're fairly better off and well placed to tackle the thing without having impact any of business goals and operations.
Right. So are you saying that the, you know, inflation and salaries and all is going to be lower than the growth, you know, top line growth or higher, or where would you put it?
Yeah, you are right. Yeah. Okay. Because for us, see, large part of our people changes come from on the operation side.
Right.
So we look at, we have 3,000 employees in matchmaking. So we look at the tech and product is probably around less than 10%.
Right.
Even if you have to give that an higher increment, that rather support function or the we're not facing much challenge. So,
right. Okay. So, last question on capital allocation. So, you know, given that there's always this one can be tempted to acquire something and so on, you know, when if an opportunity comes, is there some kind of policy that you all have created that, you know, the acquisition will be only this size and not, you know, so much I won't bet the house, or you know, or how would you fund it? Any of those kind of, you know, parameters that you'll have put.
Sushant, do you want to respond to it?
Yeah. So our views. You're able to hear me, right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
So our views as follows. There are 2-3 things. One is we are a cash generating business.
Yeah.
Approximately 10 crores of EBITDA is generated to cash. Almost all of EBITDA is generated to cash. So it is a cash generating business. Second is we have increased dividend to shareholders from what it used to be 10% or so. The payout ratio has. We'll keep evaluating forms of such giving back to shareholders. Third, on the M&A bit, there are very few opportunities. Want to do something, I don't think there are many available in the matchmaking or in the marriage services. So we keep evaluating opportunities, like the one, for example, there are 2-3 types of opportunities we're evaluating. One is, interesting companies, but not in the mainstream. Like, for example, we invest 1% in Astrovision, which is an astrology software company used in our match business, but we are not in that line. So that's one type which we'll keep evaluating. The second type is in our mainstream marriage services and matchmaking. We will keep evaluating that again based on, it has to make sense to us in terms of our overall strategy, fitment, how we can add value to our whole ecosystem. Because I don't want to acquire something for the sake of acquiring and or doesn't value. There are so many regional players. Right, but then we realize that we are strong in those markets, and just acquiring those small players may not make sense unless it really adds value. On big acquisitions, if there is an opportunity available, definitely we look at it. There is a strong cash available for us. Our ability to borrow in case it's required is also not very difficult. So given that, if something comes up there, we'll definitely evaluate that aspect also. But like I said, the thing is there has to be a strategic fit. It has to add some value to the overall scheme of things. And that's the way we look at capital allocation.
Thanks, Sushant.
Okay, great. And if there were, tomorrow, if someone were to come and, put a bid on you, what happens, are you ready at some valuation, or you think that there's a long way to go, so you want to kind of build this business and then you will look at it?
Yeah, long way to go, Sanjeev. So I tell people I'm married to matrimony, married through matrimony.com. So definitely build a long-term organization, built to last. We definitely have decades to go.
Great. No, I think that's it from our side. So thank you very much for your time. Anything that we miss, you want to add?
I think Sanjeev pretty much covered from you know startup with the purpose to kind of actually an entrepreneur to you know kind of from wedding services. I think it fairly covered. So nothing from my side. And otherwise from participants, if there are any questions, be happy to take it. Yeah, I think pretty much we are covered on it. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I guess we didn't want to cover any short-term issues. I think the whole idea was to cover long-term structural stories, sir. I think from our side, I think we are done on that. And really wish you all the very best for you know building this organization, taking it to strength, and I think this whole services, wedding services, look very exciting. So you know,
definitely, we're also excited. So,
yeah.
Thank you, Sanjeev. Thank you, Deep, for hosting
thank
us.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thank you to all the participants, and really appreciate. Yeah, thanks for your interest. Thanks, Sanjeev, and thanks,
Deep.
Thanks. Thanks. Thank you all.
Thanks.